Final Fantasy is a series that we've all pretty much tried at some point, whether you're a new gamer, a little younger, or you're an older gamer who remembers it from a while ago in the 16-bit or even the 8-bit era. Most of us have at least played a little bit of the series. And a lot of us, whether you started with Final Fantasy 15 or you started back with the original Final Fantasy, have found some enjoyment in a particular part of the series. Whether you liked Final Fantasy 3 or maybe you liked the new Final Fantasy 15, you can usually relate to one of the games. And the one that most people seem to relate to the most, or at least remember the most fondly, is Final Fantasy VII. Now, Final Fantasy VII helped to introduce several people to the RPG genre. A lot of people hadn't played their ones before that, but because they had picked up a Sony PlayStation, they wanted to try out the new 3D Final Fantasy. That's right, it was the first Final Fantasy that entered 3D. And to a lot of people, that was a big deal because it brought all types of new aspects to the series, whether it was a more cinematic look or a more emotional style from the characters. Visuals at that time, entering 3D with the PlayStation 1 and the Nintendo 64 really was that big of a deal. Even to this day now, most people relate the Final Fantasy brand to PlayStation, right? Most of us look at Final Fantasy and we go, oh, that's a PlayStation game. And that's how it was throughout the PlayStation 1's era. And then, of course, we get to PS2 and then PS3 and then PlayStation 4. It shows in the sales even. Final Fantasy 15 sold really well on the PlayStation 4, not really at all on the Xbox One. But it wasn't always like that. See, before Final Fantasy 7, it was a Nintendo game. Really, we'd look at Final Fantasy and say, oh, that's a Nintendo branded game, really, because it's all on Nintendo stuff. But really, when Final Fantasy 7 came out, there was a turning point where Final Fantasy 6 was on Nintendo systems, and then all of a sudden Final Fantasy 7 made the jump to Sony's platform, the new PS1, by the way. They were the new kids on the block at the time. And it was weird to a lot of people because there was buildup that it was going to Nintendo 64. So today, we're going to take a look at, well, what happened and why so many people believed it to go to the N64 and thought that maybe Sony pulled some underhand tactics to get it over on their side. We're also going to take a look at some of the aspects around Final Fantasy and if it was even possible to go to the Nintendo 64 with that limited cart space.
So where did this all begin? Well, it all started with a single tech demo that was revealed with screenshots back in 1995. A magazine called Die Hard Game Fan covered the tech demo and displayed several screenshots proclaiming that the stills were from an upcoming game Square was developing for the Ultra 64. See, at the time, the code name was still in effect for the Nintendo 64, and many media outlets referred to it as the Ultra 64. The magazine even went as far as to claim a release window of December 1996 for the unnamed Square project, and even named it Final Fantasy VII. Around the same time, Nintendo Power started to run an article around this demo, which helped push the narrative of a Nintendo 64-based project from Square.
I know what you're gonna say, who reads magazines? Well, back in 1995, when our cell phones looked like this, and our computers looked like this, we all did. That was the best way for us to get our news, especially around video games, because we didn't really have much online at all to really look up any of these facts, had no smartphone in our hand to check facts either. So if we saw things in a magazine, we pretty much had to either wait another month for the next magazine or pretty much just take it as fact and move on. So the fact that we were getting this buildup with an Ultra 64 game that was supposed to be for the Nintendo 64 from Square, and that we weren't used to Final Fantasy being on the PlayStation yet, yeah, a lot of us believe that, oh cool, we're getting a new 3D Final Fantasy game on the Nintendo 64. This was pretty much when printed media had a ton of influence over us. We pretty much looked at it and thought, well, I can't fact check it, so I'll have to take it as truth for now because they allowed it to be published and put out for us to buy in a magazine.
It wasn't until January 12, 1996 that Square announced the next mainline Final Fantasy game, Final Fantasy VII, going exclusively to the Sony PlayStation. As you can imagine, fans went ballistic accusing Sony of paying off Square to bring the next-gen RPG to their console instead of Nintendo's soon-to-be-released 3D console. Some even went as far as to say the screens offered in magazines were fake. However, those stills were absolutely real, leaving us all to wonder what was that tech demo and why were journalists so convinced that this was a Nintendo 64 game? During the month of August 1995, a convention known as ACM SIGGRAPH was held. This was the convention that journalists first laid eyes on the technical demo from Square. The demo depicted a battle scene using characters and enemies from Final Fantasy VI. The overall demo was interactive and controlled in real time using an Onyx workstation from SGI. This led many in attendance to speculate this was a game for the Nintendo 64, since the Onyx workstations were used as development kits for the Nintendo 64 at the time. However, it was later revealed in an interview with Hironobu Sakaguchi that the tech demo witnessed at this event was nothing more than an experiment, saying, "In August of 95, one of the US's largest CG conventions, SIGGRAPH, was held in Los Angeles. At that time, we were not sure what the next generation RPG game should look like, so as an experiment, we created a CG-based, game-like interactive demo to be presented at the show. It focused on battle scenes that were 100% real-time and polygon-based. This became the seed of Final Fantasy VII, and it was then that we decided to make this a CG-based game." Sakaguchi goes on further to explain why the CD-based media was chosen. "When we discussed designing the field scenes as illustrations or CG-based, we came up with the idea to eliminate the connection between movies and the fields. Without using blackout at all and maintaining quality at the same time, we would make the movie stop at one cut and make the characters move around on it. We tried to make it controllable even during the movies. As a result of using a lot of motion data and CG effects in still images, it turned out to be a mega capacity game, and therefore we had to choose CD-ROM as our media. In other words, we became too aggressive and got ourselves into trouble."
So it seems like the decision came down to the storage medium. Obviously, the PlayStation was using CDs, which could hold a lot more than the Nintendo 64, so there really wasn't compression needed or anything, and since the cartridges that were on the Nintendo 64 were so small, well, they pretty much had to by default with their vision that they were designing, which was a massive game at the time. I mean, they're going to use serious cinematics to try to blend gameplay and movies, kind of, if you really look at it that way. In 1995, that was kind of unheard of. And Nintendo was not happy with this decision at all. There were people who came out recently in an interview that were character creators on Square's development team at the time, where Nintendo told them, "Look, if you do this and if you leave us, never come back." And as crazy as that sounds, we haven't seen a mainline Final Fantasy game on Nintendo's home consoles since Final Fantasy VI on the Super Nintendo. But even to this day, people still argue, could Final Fantasy VII have eventually made it to Nintendo 64? Because the Nintendo 64 did evolve throughout its life that, well, could have helped it get Final Fantasy VII on that system if Square really wanted to.
There are a few instances of games going from the PlayStation and being compressed to fit onto a cartridge of the N64. One example is Mega Man Legends, which is nearly 500 megabytes when unpacked on the PlayStation, but is only a mere 32 megabytes on the Nintendo 64. Possibly the biggest accomplishment for any company at the time when it came to compressing a game for the N64 was when Resident Evil 2 was ported over. Keep in mind, Resident Evil 2 spanned across two discs on the PS1 and topped over 750 megabytes. Somehow, the team at Capcom managed to not only fit this game onto one cartridge for the N64, but they also managed to compress it to roughly 64 megabytes, making it less than 10% the size. Most people still look back on this feat of compression as impressive, even to this day. So this brings us to Final Fantasy VII, and if it was possible to port to the Nintendo 64. While many people simply take the file size of Final Fantasy and divide it by the largest size N64 cartridge recorded to find out how many cards it would take for FF7 to be feasible on Nintendo's system, the answer isn't that clear-cut, and while we will probably never know if a port of Final Fantasy VII was possible, there are some things here to keep in mind. For one, the Nintendo 64 did evolve in its lifetime along with cartridges that were used. See, cartridges originally started out around 16 megabytes at the time, but managed to finish up with 64 megabyte cartridges available. With Final Fantasy VII being developed before the N64 was even available, they were probably working with the smallest cartridges at that time. Another thing to note here is Final Fantasy VII was split up among three discs in an interesting way. For the most part, each disc had the entire game on it, minus the final boss's attacks that seemed to only exist on disc 3. The big difference between each disc were the cutscenes. In fact, if you stop in the field where there is no loading going on and change the disc out, the game will continue like normal until a cutscene is triggered, in which case the wrong scene will play out due to the wrong disc being in the system. It appears that if they could have worked out the cutscenes to be smaller in some way, they could have greatly reduced the file size. Finally, a technique called stop and swap had been developed during the N64 lifecycle that could provide the ability to change cartridges mid-game. The idea was originally brought up for the Banjo-Kazooie Banjo-Kazooie series, where developers wanted to use accomplishments from Banjo-Kazooie to unlock features in Banjo-Tooie. However, a revision with later N64 systems made this nearly impossible, as the time to change cartridges was reduced from 10 seconds down to 1 second. The ability to change cartridges mid-game could have the same effect we observed with the PS1, using multiple cartridges to solve a large file size. Of course, with the cost of the hardware in the carts at the time, meant a game with that setup could cost well over $100.
And that was pretty much it. At that point, Final Fantasy had moved over to the PlayStation, and they never looked back. There are times where I kind of think back to that moment in time where, what if Nintendo had revealed that they were using CD-based media, much like the Saturn and the PlayStation? Would things have gone different if Final Fantasy had stayed with the Nintendo 64? Probably. I actually think that Sony would have had a much harder time because they would have had no advantage over the Nintendo 64. In fact, they would have had a weaker system, and they would have really been in trouble at that point. But because CD-based media was stuck with the PlayStation 1, which could do better 3D effects than the Saturn and store more game data than Nintendo 64, it was this really good medium right between the two. And at that point, Nintendo was not going to outsell them, especially when all of the RPGs, all the Japanese software, everything other than Nintendo's IPs and some third-party games pretty much went to the PlayStation 1. But the argument about Final Fantasy VII actually running on the Nintendo 64 will go on forever, because Square's not going to go back and try to build it for the Nintendo 64, and I doubt anyone out there as fans are going to attempt it either. But it's fun to think about, because the Nintendo 64 had a ton of potential that seemed to be locked down by that cartridge file size. Thanks so much for watching today. If you enjoyed this type of video, make sure you hit the like button down below so we know to make more of these going forward. And with that, I'll see you guys in the next video.